Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for what we hope will be a really important conversation about the need for nationwide paid sick and family leave, the significant benefits that it would have for our Latino families and all Americans, and what Congress can do to ensure that working families have access to paid leave and keep themselves and their families healthy without suffering economic harm. So we're very excited. I'm Janet Merguia, President and CEO of Unidos US, the largest Latino civil rights and advocacy organization in the country. And we champion so many issues on behalf of the Latino community. But today we have the privilege of talking to a particular member of Congress about one issue that's impacting our community and so many across this country. We're so pleased to have with us U.S. Representative Stephanie Murphy, and I know she's going to share a little bit about her experience in working with Congress on this issue, among other things. But Congresswoman Murphy represents Florida's 7th Congressional District, and she sits on the very important and influential Ways and Means Committee, and also sits on the Subcommittee on Worker and Family Support, where paid family sick leave has been a key priority of hers that she has championed. And she also serves on the Armed Services Committee and is the first woman of color to lead what is called affectionately the Blue Dog Coalition in Congress. We're going to talk a little bit about more about what the Blue Dog Coalition does, but we're so pleased to have her. So what I thought I would do is highlight some of the issue as we see it working through our mission at Unidos US. And then I'll turn it over to the Congresswoman. She can give us a few observations of her own. And then I'll ask a few questions so that we can hopefully get a little bit more information out to all of our participants today. Again, we thank you for joining us. You know, what I would say from the work that we've done, both on the policy and research side, and also from the advocacy side, and Unidos US has been at the forefront of championing many of these issues on behalf of our community. But what we have seen is that during the pandemic, Latino workers have been on the front lines as essential workers, keeping our country going during this once in a century crisis. Latinos and Latinas are also the fastest growing segment of the American workforce. Yet because of the type of jobs that we have, Latinos and Latinas are also the least likely to have access to paid sick days and paid family leave. And what we're finding is that in this time, that is just unacceptable. And, you know, if I could just paint a clear picture, more than half of Latino workers, an estimated 15 million people, are unable to earn a single paid sick day, forcing them to choose between their health or the health of their families and their economic security when they get sick or need care or need to care for a sick loved one. So this is becoming an untenable situation. Only 25% of Latinos have access to paid family leave through an employer, compared to almost 50% of whites. As a result, Hispanics are disproportionately bearing the health and economic brunt of this pandemic. Latinos are twice as likely to get COVID, four times as likely to be hospitalized for it, and three times as likely to die from it. And according to our research, more than half of Latinos have either lost a job, wages, or a business due to the pandemic. And Latinos are still the group least likely to have health insurance. So if I could give one example of what this means for our workers, our recent report, the Latino Wealth Gap report and analysis, found that 15% of Latinas surveyed said they have gone to work sick because they did not have paid sick leave. This is becoming, again, untenable. Yet, despite all this, many Latinos, including immigrants in essential jobs and mixed status families, still don't have the support they need to get through these, you know, challenging times, and are still excluded from the federal and state relief efforts. And we understand how important it is for our community to get this relief now. You know, so many workers have helped get us through the pandemic at great risk, to themselves and their families. And we will depend once again on these families to help rebuild the nation and really strengthen our economy as we move forward. These workers shouldn't have to worry about taking time off when they get sick or when they need to care for a child or a loved one. So we're here today to talk about national paid sick and family leave and making sure we can get that policy and legislation and make sure that it includes everyone. And with that, I'd really like to hear from Congresswoman Stephanie Murphy. Again, you've been a champion on several fronts as it relates to both the Latino community and immigrants. But this issue in particular hits home for, I know you, but for us. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what your observations are, Congresswoman, and thank you again for your participation today and your championing this issue.
Well, thank you so much, Janet, and thank you for the opportunity to meet with Unidos, and I appreciate all of the advocacy work that your organization does. I think it's really important that we have this conversation about these public policy changes that are needed by all Americans, but especially the Latino community, as you laid out in your remarks. And you know, as you mentioned, I have long been a supporter of creating a reliable pathway for hardworking Americans to obtain paid family and medical leave. You know, the United States is one of the few countries in the world with no permanent national law that provides paid leave of any kind. And the laws that have extended partial or temporary protections have really failed to include the full range of workers. And so I think it's really distressing how few Americans are lucky enough to work for an employer that pays or provides paid leave benefits. And even fewer Americans are lucky enough to live in a state that offers this benefit. And I think that when it comes to paid leave, access can't be, and it shouldn't be based on where you live or who you work for. And here in Florida, my constituents and I, we live in a state that doesn't offer paid leave or even unpaid leave. And even with the unpaid leave available under the federal FMLA is inaccessible for 63% of working Floridians. So I really understand the urgency for Congress to put forward a nationwide strategy. And, you know, I understand this from personal experience.
I
know a number of years ago, as I was thinking about starting a family, I received a really exciting job offer. But when I asked about the leave policy, shockingly, this Fortune 500 company that likes to tout being like a good place for women to work, they told me I could take any vacation that I had accrued and then 3 months of unpaid leave. And, you know, like so many families faced with a similar predicament, I wondered, how could I make this work? How can you go for 3 months without pay and in order to have the family I wanted? And so the answer really was is that I couldn't make it work. And so I had to pass on the job offer. And I know that my experience pales in comparison to the countless working families who don't have the luxury of choice when making employment decisions. But you know what? Now, as a member of Congress, I have the privilege and the ability to work towards policies that will expand the definition of the type of worker who can take time to care for themselves and others while maintaining their economic security. And I'm really proud, in specific here to Central Florida, I'm really proud to represent a really diverse district in Central Florida. Over 1 in 4 of my constituents are of Hispanic descent. This is similar to the overall population of Florida, where Latinos make up about 26% of the population. And my district is home to a lot of working families that are, sandwiched between the responsibilities of caring for aging parents and then the need to care for their young children. And a lot of these families live in under one roof in these multi-generational households, particularly among Latino families. And so it goes without a doubt that the Latino community has a distinct dedication to caring for family. We know that it takes more than big hearts to cause extended family to live together. Instead, it's often due to economic constraints. And so these economic constraints are in part tied to the disproportionate amount of service industry jobs in my district that often pay low wages, have limited benefits. And these folks were among the most jeopardized by the COVID-19 pandemic, as you mentioned, that you discussed. And these jobs really aren't the kinds of jobs that can easily transition to remote work. So what were otherwise normal workers become frontline workers who were then at risk of catching COVID and spreading it to the children and the elders in these multi-generational households. Right. And, I think this pandemic illustrated to us that the importance of universal paid leave, yeah, and the need for it. And so I think, you know, we did try to make some attempts at addressing it narrowly within the pandemic. And so we were able to create the first ever federal paid leave framework in the bipartisan Families First Coronavirus Response Act. And so essentially what that was 2 weeks of paid sick leave at the employee's regular rate of pay if an employee was quarantined or was experiencing COVID-19 symptoms. 2 weeks of paid sick leave at two-thirds of the employee's regular rate of pay for employees who had to care for an individual who was in quarantine or a child whose school or childcare provider was closed or unavailable due to COVID. And then up to an additional 10 weeks of paid expanded FMLA at two-thirds of the regular pay for anyone who had to care for a child or who didn't have their schools or childcare providers open. Right. And employers were required to pay this benefit to their workers, and those who did were swiftly reimbursed by the federal government at 100%. And so I was really involved in writing these provisions, and while they weren't perfect and didn't cover enough workers and unfortunately expired at the end of 2020, what I think is hopeful about it is that we were able to get bipartisan support for this idea. Mm-hmm. And we were able to lay the foundation for what future legislation could look like outside of the narrow definition around COVID. And, you know, as I'll just wrap up by saying, you know, as we look forward, House Democrats are really committed to addressing paid leave and create a nationwide system. There are a lot of ideas circulating around about how we do it and how to get it across the finish line so it can begin benefiting families immediately.
That's amazing because, you know, obviously we're fortunate to have someone who not only has your knowledge, but your experience. And, you know, you see what's happened in your own life, you're seeing what's happening in your constituents, and, you know, recognizing the diversity of your constituents and uniquely what challenges they're facing, you know, your ability to put that to work in the committee that is overseeing this particular area of law really is so helpful, because that knowledge with your experience and lens, and even as someone who's an immigrant to this country, you're bringing that sensibility and the real world when it comes to knowing where the gaps are right now for people who are working so hard trying to make ends meet. So your ability to bring that to life and to address those gaps through this legislative language and making sure that we're going to be filling that and understanding that, yes, unfortunately, some of these provisions expired in 2020, but it's all the more reason why we have to keep working to make sure we can do this. Let me ask you, on a related area, you know, we're hearing that companies with 50 or more employees are required to provide up to 12 weeks of unpaid time off. We know that that currently is the law, thanks to the Family and Medical Leave Act of 1993. By the way, I work for President Clinton. I'm really proud of that act. Yet just this winter, 63% of Americans said they had been living paycheck to paycheck since the pandemic hit. So you have a situation where workers literally have to decide whether to take care of themselves or a loved one and risk eviction or continue working at the expense of their well-being and the health of their colleagues and families. And that just seems so unfair. How are you reconciling the needs of businesses, but also the needs of the workers to address this, you know, situation? What's been your experience in seeing this bill come through Congress? And maybe just add briefly, what are the obstacles for us to get this through? You're seeing that in real time as you're negotiating this. What are some of your observations, Congresswoman?
Well, I think I think what you laid out is underscores the need for a nationwide framework that is flexible enough to incorporate existing employers who are providing paid leave benefits and existing paid leave state plans, and then fills the gaps for the remaining workers who don't have access to paid leave. So we have to figure out a way to build that network and stitch together all the different ways in which somebody might be able to get access, but to do so in a way that reaches all workers, not just some workers. And I think, you know, there's a lot of conversation around when you talk about ops. So while there are a lot of ideas floating around as to how we structure that, how we ensure that we have this nationwide coverage, some thoughts are exist around how do we pay for it, and how do we ensure that the businesses, like say small businesses, are able to afford it and not have it impact them in a negative way. With the COVID model, we reimbursed businesses that did this. So a lot of different, approaches. And so
there were supports there for businesses. Yes. And protections. And I think a lot of times people kind of forget that we're not just looking at it from the worker perspective, that there have been efforts to accommodate the employers in all of this, because we do know it can be a burden for some. But the truth is that the vast majority of American voters, around 80%, support the idea of a national paid leave program. And we seem to be the only industrialized country that doesn't offer paid leave on a national basis. So there is a compelling case for us to do it. I know you've been working as co-chair of the Blue Dog Coalition. I'll tell our webinar participants that the Blue Dog Coalition is a group of Democrats focused on fiscal responsibility, but also a pragmatic approach to legislating. They're oftentimes referred to as consensus builders. And here you are, Congresswoman, the chair of that consensus builder group of Democrats. So tell me, what are the main priorities that you're looking for in that sort of sweet spot of pragmatic, but also wanting to get a solution, but also wanting to be fiscally responsible, which a lot of people appreciate? What's been the dynamics, and how is that, what have been the outcomes of that in your coalition?
Yeah, so our coalition believes that any proposed legislation should have a plan for how it would be paid for. You know, I think you need to make sure that we do it in a fiscally responsible way. But what I think is also important is that we want to make sure that workers and businesses who are struggling in this moment have the support they need, while also being able to extend this benefit to the American worker. I think the way that the coalition works, though, is that we try to find the solution that is as bold as possible, trying to get us to our goal, but that has the votes to actually get passed into law. Because the reality is that we could sit in Washington and discuss all the many ways in which we could ensure nationwide paid leave is available. But if we can't get it through the House and the Senate and signed into law by President Biden, which I know they're interested in making sure that we address this issue, if we can't get it signed into law, then it doesn't help any families. And it becomes an academic exercise. And that's not the, I believe as legislators, we should be trying to find the boldest legislative solution we can get that can become law.
Since you mentioned it, and I think it's important to reference that as part of the American Families Plan, President Biden is calling for a $225 billion investment to provide 12 weeks of paid parental, family, and sick leave to virtually all of American workers in the next 10 years. Under the president's plan, workers could get up to $4,000 a month while they are off, with at least two-thirds of their average weekly wages replaced. I think that's 80% for the lowest wage workers. I'm just curious, what are the chances that we can get something like that passed in the Congress? And is that aligned with the coalition of Democrats that are the blue dogs? Are they supporting that? Are you all supporting that?
So I actually was at the White House last week or this week, speaking with the vice president about paid leave and childcare. Yeah. And the way that we see it is that those elements of enable the American workforce, childcare, paid leave, these types of things enable the American workforce. And as we look to have a strong economic recovery, ways in which we can get workers back into the workforce is to provide supports for these types of situations. So they're not making the decision between whether or not they have to stay home or to care for a loved one or can continue to work. And so I think the commitment is there. The other thing is, I think there is bipartisan recognition that we do need paid leave in some form or another. And we see that because during the pandemic, we were able to pass the small paid leave expansion measures on a bipartisan basis. And we have heard from our Republican colleagues, who the Blue Dogs work an awful lot with across the aisle in order to get things done. We've heard from our Republican colleagues, and even the previous Republican administration has said that this was an important part. So I think that gives me a lot of hope that we are going to be able to get something done, especially now that we have President Biden championing it and putting it in his proposal. Now it's up to Congress in a bipartisan, bicameral way, you know, Republicans and Democrats and senators and House members working together to write out the specifics that can pass through.
Well, we're very fortunate to have you in Congress championing this issue, because it gives us great hope as an organization representing many of the Latino community. It gives us great hope and encouragement that you're in the trenches there of these subcommittees and committees that are most relevant to creating this legislation, and that you're trying to build this bridge not just among Democrats to kind of find that consensus, but trying to find that bipartisan support. It's really a pleasure to work with you and alongside you in moving the Latino community forward. I know we've had a chance to talk about other issues, but today we wanted to really focus on this need to access paid sick and family leave, and recognize that it's time for us as a country to build the support for that, and to make sure from a Latino community perspective, people recognize the need for equity. I mean, our workers have been on the forefront in those trenches, sacrificing themselves, and we need to make sure that they're getting more options for how they could take care of themselves and their families and continue to work and protect their interests. So I really just want to thank you and our audience for tuning in. We stand ready at Unidos US to secure economic stability for all working families and expanded access to paid leave for all workers. And hope you all who are joining in on our webinar today will follow our work on these issues and other important issues by visiting our social media pages and our website at unidosus.org. And Congresswoman, I'll give you the last word. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Janet. And I really look forward to working with you and Unidos to ensure that the Latino community has the equal opportunity to pursue the American dream. And these worker support programs like paid leave and childcare and other things that you advocate for are key components in enabling Latinos and Americans all across this country to pursue the American dream and live a good life focused and on family. And we always say that we have strong family values, but we have to show that we value families by passing legislation that supports families.
Well, we're both fortunate to have experienced, I think, that American dream, and we're hoping that we can extend that, you know, to everyone, including all of these diverse communities that are working so hard to keep America going. So thank you, Congresswoman. Appreciate it. We'll continue to work with you, and hopefully we will be able to see real progress on this issue right now when we need it most. So thanks again for all your support and your leadership.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, everyone, for joining us today. We'll be back with another segment sometime soon, so stay tuned to our website for other opportunities to join on important topics, especially as they impact the Latino community. Thank you all.